Straight up. Watching Christians United Broadcasting Network. See you be in, where we want to see you be encouraged in Jesus' name. Welcome back to your Way Happy Bible Study on See You Be In. Glory to God. Okay, we're in it, aren't we? Let's keep going. Now we are at Matthew chapter 24, and we're still in verse 14. Let me make myself a note here. Starting at verse 14. And this gospel of the kingdom, the gospel means good news. It doesn't mean a proposition. The false gospel is that Jesus came and said, I'll do this for you if you'll do this. That's a proposition. That's not a gift. But that's what false religion has spread all over the world. We have really dropped the ball, okay? The gospel, which means good news, of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness. We're just supposed to tell people that Jesus died for them and he loves them and give them the word of God. And if they're born with the temple inside them, the word itself by the Spirit draws them to follow him. My sheep hear my voice and they follow me. Jesus said, okay, they're already his sheep. He already died for them. He already chose them out and died for them. They're already saved before they ever know who he is. Let me tell you a little, just a short testimony here. Most of you that know me, you already know this. When my youngest daughter was born, it was a huge emergency. She and I both nearly died. Had I not been in the hospital when the big emergency happened, we both would have died. And that's just God's grace. But he showed me something really important, because I was faced with a situation where the doctor told me I might not be able to save you both. And I said, save her. Save her. Okay. Save her first. I don't want to cry. I don't have time to cry right now. Save her. So he shot me in the leg with a military dose of morphine and cut me. And I felt it. I felt it. I felt myself get gutted like a fish. And I lost consciousness. I was praying when I lost consciousness, and I thought I was dying. I really did think I was dying. I didn't expect to wake up. And obviously I did, you know, but my point here is that my sacrifice saved her life. And it was not contingent on whether she ever even knew I existed. Had I died and she grew up with another mother and never even heard my name, that does not negate my sacrifice for her. She was alive because I made that choice. and it had nothing to do with her. Response, knowledge, acceptance, anything. And God showed me that that's kind of how it is, okay, with our salvation. He made the choice, and he saved us. And it had nothing to do with us, but we reap the benefits, whether we know about it or not, whether we understand it or not. Even if we don't know his name, his sacrifice saved us. Just like my sacrifice saved her life. And that's how it is. Okay? And that's all I'm going to do about, that's all I'm going to say about that. But anyway, he's taught me through a lot of my life experiences how this works. And she's alive because I made that choice and not because she received it or knew about it or could accept it or anything like that. That was a gift I gave her. And he gave us that gift. He gave us that gift of salvation. And we're already saved even if we don't know who he is. But the kingdom, it says, the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then shall the end come. And the gospel has been preached in every nation and island group in the world as we speak. In verse 15, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. Whoso readeth, let him understand. Now, this happened in 70 AD. The thing that hath been is the thing that shall be, and the thing that hath been done is the thing that shall be done, and there is nothing new under the sun. Nothing new. And I'll give you the scriptures for that. That's Ecclesiastes 1:9. Let's go over there real quick. So, it's right after Proverbs. Ecclesiastes 1:9-11. The thing that hath been is that which shall, it is that which shall be, and that which is done is that which shall be done, and there is no new thing under the sun. These things happen over and over and over again. In verse 10, is there anything whereof it may be said, see, this is new? No, there's not. It hath been already of old time, which was before us. Now think about what that's saying. Cell phones? Not new. Internet? Not new. Space program? Not new. A situation where it looks like the seals are opening? Not new. This happened in 70 AD as well. You had the situation where you had the false Christ, you had the false Caesar, you had war, you had famine, you had pestilence and death. You had all of these things back then too. It's called foreshadowing in the scriptures. And in verse 11, there is no remembrance of former things. Neither shall there be any remembrance of things that are to come with those that shall come after. This is saying there's been an internet, there's been space program. I mean, it probably clear back to Nimrod. The arrows he was shooting at the sky were missiles. And then after the flood, you had all these things in Noah's time. You actually had genetic manipulation in the time of Noah, with technology like we have now. And we don't remember. See, it says there is no remembrance of former things. And you're saying, well, how do we remember then? And I'm saying verse 10 is how we remember. Because it says, is there anything whereof it may be said, see, this is new? It hath been already of old time, which was before us. That's why we know. Noah and his three sons built the ark. We translate that by hand, okay? We translate that into no technology. We start we think, okay, they didn't have technology. Well, yeah, they did, just like we do now. But the ark was very specially constructed to be like a cork. It had a lid on it. And when it was deluged, it popped right back up to the top. And our modern ships don't do that. Okay? That's why they were all lost back in Noah's time. And that's why they're all going to be lost in our time, too. So keep in mind that these things are not new. There was genetic manipulation back then, just like there is now. Do you know back then, in Noah's time, they created creatures that didn't exist before, like satyrs that were half goat, half man, mermaids that were half fish, half man. They created centaurs that were half horse, half man. These, to us, we regard them as mythological, but it's not mythology. It's technology is what it is. It's genetic manipulation. And now what they're doing is trying to create half sheep, half man. They've created half monkey, half spider, half lion, half, I mean, they're doing all, they are creating creatures that have never existed before because they are manipulating genetics, the DNA, okay? Now, we are over here in, let me get back over here in Matthew 24, and we just read 15. We were talking about how these things also happened in 70 AD. You had the signs of the seals, okay? You had the Caesar, who was the Antichrist. You had Antiochus Epiphanes, who defiled their temple by slaughtering a pig on the altar. Then you have a modern day Antichrist who's of the same heritage as those Romans who defiled the Second Temple. He's a Roman. Pope Francis is an Argentinian. He's born of two Roman-born parents. He's Roman. He may have grown up in Argentina, but he's a born Roman. All right. And during the second half, they'll call him Peter the Roman. Now, let's just clarify that this has happened before. Just as Ecclesiastes showed us, these things happen over and over and over again. All right. In verse 16, then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains. Now, they fled on foot back then and on donkeys and horses and camels and whatever they could. But in the modern times, they're going to be airlifted out on airplanes. Let me show you something. Revelation chapter 12 in verse 14. And to the woman, that's Israel, were given two wings of a great eagle. That's an airplane, ladies and gentlemen, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place, where she is nourished for a time, times and half a time, that's 3.5 years, from the face of the serpent. Airplanes, okay? These things happen over and over again. In verse 17, let him which is on the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house. Neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes. There's a sense of urgency here that once you see the temple defiled, you better run for your life. And you guys that are in Israel, the children of God in the land of Israel, when you start seeing these things, you head to the airport, not to the mountains. Head to the airport. They're going to airlift you out, probably to Petra. And God does protect his own, the whole second half, the remnant. He preserves them alive. They are not objects of his wrath. He preserves them alive and he brings them forward into the king's millennium to preserve their bloodlines and bring their bloodlines forward into the millennium. In verse 19, and woe unto them that are with child and to them that give suck in those days. But pray that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. See, on the Sabbath day, they're not allowed by the law to travel. religious Jews. In verse 21, for then shall be great tribulation. Notice this is the second half that is called the great tribulation, Jacob's trouble. It's the second half. Such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. And except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved. So you're looking, when the second half starts, it looks like to the world that the 7 years has just started. Nope. The 7 years is half over when this starts. But the Jews, it looks like to many teachers that the Jews' 7 years starts at the midpoint and goes forward, okay? But those days were shortened down to 3.5. The Jews don't have 7 years. They get 3.5. Except those days be shortened, there should no flesh be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. For the elect's sake, God loves his own. All of those who are born with the temple inside them. In verse 23, then if any man shall say unto you, lo, here is Christ, or there, believe it not. For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, see, first seal again, and wonders insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. If it were possible, they should deceive the very elect. Jesus doesn't allow that to happen. He loves us. Behold, I have told you before. Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. Behold, he is in the secret chambers, believe it not. Now, let me tell you a little short story here, very short. I have a friend that lives in Israel that I've known for decades, okay? Almost 3 decades. She is, or about 20, probably 20 years, a little bit more than that. She told me like 10 years ago, probably almost 10 years ago, that we were talking, and I had been trying to teach her about all these things, right? About who she is and how special she is. Her parents immigrated to Israel from Iraq. They were descendants of the Babylonian captivity. And my friend, she's younger than I am, but she was born in Israel. Okay, her parents immigrated, but I was talking to her about these things, and she told me. She said, the rabbis are telling the people that the Messiah is in the desert in a secret chamber waiting to be revealed. And I said, what? Are you serious? I know. Somebody else has coined that phrase, but that's exactly what I said. Okay. Really? And she said, yeah. And I said, get this. Look at this scripture. And I read this scripture to her in 26. Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. Behold, he is in the secret chambers, believe it not. And she just went. We had a really good time studying together. She actually went back to college to take religious studies to find out how special she is as a blood descendant of Abraham. So the Jewish people are just the apple of God's eye. He loves them so much. In verse 27, so see, this is past fulfillment. The rabbis were telling the people this 10 years ago. If they shall say he's in the desert in the secret chambers, believe it not. And they were saying that 10 years ago. They were telling the people in Israel that 10 years ago. So that's past fulfillment right there. For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west. Now the lightning is coming out of the east, Middle East. But it shines even unto the west from the West, we can see what's going on over there. Global communications, ladies and gentlemen. We can see what's going on over there, can't we? So shall the coming of the Son of Man be. So he's showing up over there, and then we'll find out about it over here. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together. The carcass is the nation of Israel. They are physically alive, but they are spiritually dead because they don't know their God anymore. They don't know him. They got it. My friend who's a Jew, she had no idea why the world hates the Jews. No clue. And I suspect that most Jews have no idea why the whole world hates them. It's because the world is jealous, green with envy that they were chosen. In verse 29, immediately after the tribulation of those days. What was that? Oh. I'll call you back on the break, my love. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall, of those days. Did you hear that? Now we're looking at past fulfillment in verse 26. And here we are in 29. It's talking about the tribulation of those days. It's talking first half. We'll start again in 29 as soon as we get back after the break. Don't go away. Right up.